taking time out from the day to learn a little bit. This is really one of my favorite things that we do here in Yeshiva. And it's tied for first with a lot of things. But the notion that as a Rebbe, get to share Torah with the parents, and for that matter, for the kids who walk by and we see that, you know, Torah isn't just something that we tell them to do, but we're always looking to grow, we're always looking to learn and to further ourselves, is incredibly impactful on them, on us, on everybody. What I'd like to talk about today, the name of today's shiur is called Light in the Strangest of Places. The notion that we can find, or that specifically inspiration and meaning and spirituality is to be found perhaps sometimes in the places we wouldn't always assume for them or expect for them to be. Being that, I'd like to speak about that vis-a-vis ourselves, and especially vis-a-vis our children, teaching our children, setting an example for our children. You know, that's what means the most to us. So, if we go through our sources, there's a pattern that comes up in different Jewish sources, which very strongly links up the rise of the Greek Empire to the end point of Nebuah, of prophecy. That in Jewish history, at what point did prophecy end? The final prophet was Malachi, which happened at some point at the beginning of the Second Temple, perhaps somewhat into the Second Temple, and at what point did the golden years of Greece rise in Alexander the Great? So we have a whole bunch of sources that line those two eras up together. Did they happen exactly in the same year? Probably not in the exact same year. Within the same 150 years? Seems to be most certainly. But our Sfarim, our books, talk about that at length. So what exactly does that mean for us? That, what would the connection between Greece and what Greece represented, or what they tried to do with the Jewish people, and the notion of prophecy, which was so central and so integral to Jewish life, and that moment coming to an end, and the shift in Jewish life and service of Hashem, which resulted as a result of us not having prophecy. So I'd like to point out for us at first, the first Mishnah in Pirkei Avot, it's the first source on our sheet right over here. The first Mishnah in Pirkei Avot, Ethics of Our Fathers, would be how it's translated in English, goes through the Mesoras HaTorah. It gives us, before it starts teaching us the sayings and the teachings and the lessons of our sages, it actually gives us a little bit of Jewish history. From Moses till nowadays, what was the chain of tradition of Judaism? So if we see, I put it in English and Hebrew there, the first Mishnah. We'll read it together. Moshe kibel Torah miSinai. It's a good place to start. Moshe received the Torah from Mount Sinai. Umasra liYehoshua, and the reason that that's highlighted is that's going to be our main word. And Moshe passed it down to Yehoshua. He handed it over. He made Yehoshua, who was his right-hand man in his lifetime, he made him in charge. He passed down. Tradition would now move from Moshe to Joshua. After Yehoshua, the Yehoshua l'Zakenim, Yehoshua gave that over to the elders, v'Zakenim l'Neviim, the elders passed that over to the prophets, v'Neviim masruha la'anshei Knesset Hagadola, and the prophets, when their time ended, they handed it over to the men of the Great Assembly, which was the last main body of Jewish law central that we had. So a curious thing happens. I'd like to point out two curious things in this Mishnah. The first is we clearly have a passing down of one person to another person, or of one person to a group of people, or a group of people to another group of people. Except for the first one. It says, Moshe kibel Torah me Sinai. Sinai is just a place. Sinai is a mountain. It would have made sense, since the entire Mishnah is dealing with real people or groups of people, it should say Moshe received the Torah from Hashem, and then Moshe passed it down to Yehoshua. So what's the notion that we have this place, Moshe got the Torah from Sinai? What's the focus that's supposed to happen there? That question I'm going to put aside for a moment. The stronger one is the language, and we have it highlighted on the sheet, that the word that means to pass down a tradition is Mesorah. Moshe kibel Torah miSinai, umasra liYehoshua. He passed it down to Yehoshua. But when Yehoshua gives the Torah to the next group, the Zakenim, the elders, that word Masra isn't there. It just says, and Joshua to the elders, and the elders to the prophets. We understand. Yet the word makes a comeback when we switch over from the prophets to the men of the Great Assembly. It should have just said, V'neviim le'anshei Knesset HaGadola, and the prophets handed it over to the men of the Great Assembly. But comes back that word again. The Nevi'im Masruha, and the Nevi'im passed it down to the men of the Great Assembly. So the syntax is just not parallel. Either use the word Masruha, they passed it down at every stage of the chain, or only use it the first time and ignore the word the rest of the time. But what's the idea that the word shows up at the beginning, and then disappears, and then comes back at the very end? Our sources tell us, and I saw this specifically in the writings of Rav Moshe Shapiro, who's one of the great, great progenitors of real teachers of Hasidus in Jerusalem. He says that the word Masruha, the reason that the word comes twice, the first time the Torah is ever handed over from Moshe to Yehoshua, and then the last time the Torah is ever handed over, which is from the prophets to the men of the Great Assembly, is because there was an entirely different mode, an entirely different method of the way the Torah was given over post-prophets. Meaning the way Moshe gave the Torah to Yehoshua was essentially the same system, the same way of Torah approach as Yehoshua did to the elders, and was the same approach as the elders did to the prophets. But post-prophecy, once prophecy was over, the way Torah was going to have to be passed down was completely different than beforehand. And that's why the word Masruha comes back again, as if to say there's an entire new way of Mesoras HaTorah. There's an entire new way that that tradition and that approach to Torah was being given. What was that? What was the difference? Well, Moshe, Yehoshua, the Zakenim, the Nevi'im, they had a prophetic understanding of Torah. They had open gilui, miracles. They had incredible visions of Hashem, they saw open miracles, they were in touch with prophets, and the way the Torah was being passed down from that stage, those first stages of Judaism, was one with a very clear God awareness, and a very open and obvious God awareness. You had a prophet, you could talk to him, he could tell you exactly what Hashem, or she could tell you exactly what Hashem wanted you to do, or could perform a miracle, or perform or predict the future. There was a real openness about Hashem. But with the end of prophecy, Judaism completely changed. Torah study completely changed. There was no more of an openness anymore. But there was, so to speak, a certain darkness, a certain confusion in Torah study. You didn't have the open revelation of Har Sinai type, a prophetic type of revelation, but you had to search, you had to grapple in the darkness, so to speak, to try to figure out what exactly is it that Hashem wants from us. Because there's no more prophets. So when the prophets handed off tradition to the next group, the Anshei Knesset HaGedolah, it was an entirely new way of approaching Hashem. Now this doesn't just mean Torah study. This means every aspect of Judaism. That in the early days, the days of Yehoshua, the days of Moshe, the days of the prophets, it wasn't just Torah study which was in a revealed way. It was Jewish life. And every aspect of Jewish life was in a way that was simpler. What do we think about the most? I don't know, how to raise our kids. We want to do right by them. We want to do good by them. I don't know. I'm assuming that if you lived in the time of the prophets, you could go to a prophet and you could say, I don't know, my kid's putting posters up in her room of, you know, whoever the biblical Justin Bieber was at the time. And I don't know. Should I tell her to take him down? Should I tell her to keep it up? I don't know, I have a fight, is this worth a fight? Which camp, which yeshiva should they go to? Which college should they go to? How should I handle this parenting situation? I assume that the prophet would tell you exactly the perfect advice and meet straight from God, and it would work perfectly. In post-prophetic times, no idea really what to do. We have ideas, we study, but we don't know. It's a tremendous struggle. Every aspect of life is that. I have a friend, his colleague, a well-known Rav in Jerusalem. So all day long he's giving lectures, he's going to this place, that place, he's giving lectures on Torah topics, advanced Torah topics, parenting topics, raising children. So whatever, he has a Twitter. Well, who doesn't have Twitter these days? The other day he posted a Twitter. So what is it? It's a picture of his refrigerator. It's a picture of his refrigerator door open. You got like a tuna casserole there, and you have like your orange juice. And then there's a pair of boots. There's a pair of muddy boots right there, right in between the tuna casserole and the orange juice. And the caption they included was, "Well, of course I put her boots in the refrigerator. She tried my shoes on." And he kind of hashtags like, you know, "Help me raise my daughters," right? Here's a guy, he's going around giving parenting lectures all over the place. He's got his students following him everywhere. "Teach me, Rabbi, how do..." In the meantime, he comes home, he's got the boots in the refrigerator. I have no idea how to handle this. I have no idea how to do this. I mean, of course I'm using, you know, somebody else as an example of, you know, parenting flummoxes. I mean, in my home, you know, just to be honest, I never have any issues whatsoever. I mean, I come home at the end of the day, one kid brings me my slippers, the other one brings me the post. Next one, the pipe, and I sit in the easy chair, and, you know, they tell me about their, everything's just, I mean, in my house, it's not like I actually need to change into a bathing suit before bath time, because I know that it's Typhoon Lagoon. That's not, that never happens in my time. I was thinking, you know, remember in the 80s when somebody figured out how to sell jeans that were all bleached, you know, down the side, you know, or even nowadays. You know, the most expensive things is the fashion with the jeans, whatever. It's, you know, it's, they call it stonewashed or whatever. You know, it's ripped. You know, you can. It's way more expensive to buy a set of jeans where the knees are all ripped out. Everything is frayed. You know, so you're like, "Wow, where'd you get those jeans? You look like you're homeless. Wow, can I buy those? Those are really expensive." You know, I want to create a line of clothing for, you know, working professional parents with kind of crusted over food on the dress suits. You know, kind of meaning that'll be the thing. Like, you'd show up. Brooks Brothers, whatever you can get in this. It would just be kind of like lasagna, you know, from last night, kind of smeared onto the pocket. It would be part of the suit, you know, or, you know, you'd have the different lines. You'd have like tuna casserole from the night with a baby, you know, spit up in the corner. And that would just become the normal. You'd spend that, because then my wardrobe would really go up, you know, tremendously. I used to have the thing, I had a system. Supper would have all of the, you know, lasagna all over the suit, but then bath time would almost wash it all off, you know. It was like a standing dry cleaner. It's a great system. So anyway, my home doesn't have any of that stuff. So he had to tweet about his daughters. But the point is it used to be you had confusion about how to serve God right, or how to do the right thing, and you had revelation as to how to do that. And nowadays, we don't have that. We don't have the prophecy anymore. And that's what it means here, that with the ending of the time of prophecy, there was a new way that we were going to have to serve Hashem, a new Mesorah, that the Anshei Knesset HaGedolah had to pass down post-prophecy. Why do our sources tie this in with Greece? Well, Greece was the culture that was completely focused on the idea of taking the miraculous out, taking the God out of the world. Let's explain this entire world in a way of mathematics, in a way of philosophy, a play of philosophy. Let's glorify the human body or the athletics. The physicality is everything. There's no God behind it. There's no afterlife after this. And that's a darkness. And therefore, when we lost prophecy, that naturally came along with the ascension of an empire, which is one which is completely focused on the physical, on the body, on the here and now, without looking for something that may be deeper, something that may be beyond it. Hence, the fall of prophecy overcomes. The fall of prophecy happens at the same moment as the rise of Greece. So we've got a different way now that we have to serve Hashem. But interestingly, there's a tremendous advantage now that we're stuck in this confusion. There's a tremendous gain that we can have from the fact that we have so much less clarity in what's the right thing to do or how to study Torah than we might have had in the prophetic times. And what is that? And it's a phenomenon that we all experience, that sometimes when a person doesn't have to work for something, it's kind of, we're overwhelmed from above with just clarity. The fact that we didn't have to put in the effort for it makes it mean less to us. Not only does it perhaps mean less to us, but it doesn't stick with us as well. Whereas if there's something that we really needed to work on and struggle with and search for, and then we can reach that goal, we internalize it so much more. I'll give you a proof to this. We have two luchos. The Torah was given twice. The first set of luchos, as it is described in Shmos, Perek Yates, Parshas Yisro, describes an overpowering experience. Kolos u'brakim, lightning, thunder, kol shofar chazak ma'od, some type of shofar sounds. The people were terrified, they were overcome. Who wrote the first luchos? Etzba Elokim. God himself wrote those luchos. That was an overpowering receiving of the Torah, and the luchos themselves were written by none other than God. The people just had to be there, and they were just overwhelmed with God. But there was something about the fact that they didn't really have to struggle at all for it, and they just kind of were standing there as the godliness or the experience washed over them, that how long did those luchos last for? Moshe comes down, it was 40 days later, people were worshiping a golden statue. Those luchos got smashed to pieces. As incredible as they were, and as incredible as the revelation that came along with them were, perhaps the fact that the people didn't have to work for it made it less meaningful for them, and it made it so quick for them to just lose that inspiration. Just think about that same generation. They saw all of the plagues, they saw the sea split, and then the minute they saw tremendous overwhelming miracles. But the minute anything goes wrong, they ran out of water, ran out of food, and they're right back to where they were beforehand. Something about being overwhelmed by godliness, where you didn't really have to work for it, doesn't make it last as long. Let's look at the second luchos in contradistinction. The second luchos, Moshe walks up the mountain, lonely individual. We don't have sounds overpowering. We don't have this description of the people blown away. And who writes the second luchos? It's not Hashem. Moshe chisels them out himself. He sits up there, banging into the rock. So I would think that's a much lower level of the second luchos. A human being, even though it's Moshe, carved them out. Aren't the first ones more special? But the second ones are the ones that lasted. The second ones never broke. The first ones came from God. They were incredible, overwhelming revelation. They didn't last. Because maybe we didn't have to work for it. The second luchos, which didn't have the fanfare, that didn't have the excitement, and they had a lonesome Moses up on top of the mountain with a hammer and a chisel banging out the letters, where there was effort and toil in there, that's what lasted. So there's a certain comfort in there, that we're way more confused in our how to be good Jews, or how to raise our children the right way, or how to do the right thing. We have to search much more. We're not going to get a fortune cookie to open up that's going to tell us the right thing to do, a magic eight ball. We're not going to get a prophet, we're not going to get a prophecy. But the fact that we're going to have to work, and we're going to have to search, is going to ultimately, and our children are going to have to do that, and we're going to have to search with them, is going to end up being what makes it last. Is what's going to end up making it, this fight against Greece, is what's going to end up making it a permanent and staying type of meaningful lesson for us. You know, in Yiddishkeit, we believe in the concept of Bashert. I mean, some people are afraid of that. You know, some people are afraid of getting too romantic and this and that. But, you know, those guys are wrong. I mean, you know, we believe in a notion that there's a soulmate for everybody, and that, you know, that you should believe in such a thing. There's a predetermined soulmate. Are we promised to find that person? A lot of literature on this. Does it mean you absolutely meet that person even? It's what to be looked into. There's a funny thing, if you look in the Bible, where do all the couples meet, or most of them meet? Where's the place where the well? It's an amazing thing, right? Eliezer meets Rivka at the well. Yaakov meets Rachel at the well. Last, right in the parshas coming up, Moshe is going to meet Zipporah at the well. It's an amazing thing. I don't know what today's equivalent of the well is exactly. You know, in high school, sometimes I think it's like the water fountain. You know, sometimes I'm like, hey, what's going on? Boy, that was a hard history test. We're not in the same class. Oh, yeah, whatever. You know. What time is it? Oh, you've got a watch on. Why ask me to? Oh, whatever. People make conversation. But in the Bible, what's the idea of the well? I'll share with you a beautiful idea that I saw in the name of the Rabbi Cherebi. He says, the well, which was the place of where the soulmates all found one another, and many of them did. He says, if you go to a well, if you dig a well, right, you don't create the water. You don't make what's down there. The water was always there. That stream might have been there for thousands of years, right? So the idea that the water was always there is a reference to the idea that this was a soulmate, that the notion of a soulmate, that these two souls are supposed to be together. It was determined, it was supposed to be from a long time ago. You don't create the water, it's there. But you know what you had to do still? The idea of Bashert does not excuse us from having to search for that person, from having to improve our character traits and make ourselves worthy of finding that person. And for that matter, after we've even found that person, maybe after we've married that person, it doesn't excuse us of constantly having to work on that relationship. Bashir doesn't mean happily ever after. It means that these souls were supposed to be together, but you've got to work. So the Rebbe said the water at the bottom of the well represents the predetermined soulmate. But how did you get there? Well, you had to dig. You had to schlep. You had to get the shovel. And you know something, what happens? Well, sometimes they clog up. Sometimes, you know, naturally what happens, you got to open it up again. You have to work on the relationship. So they all met at the well because the well is the reference to the idea of a soulmate. It's there, but you have to work for it. Even things predetermined, even spiritual things, doesn't excuse us from having to work. If we want it to be meaningful, we're going to have to dig, get a little dirt under our fingernails. That's the idea. So once again, we don't have prophets. We don't have God, we don't have God revealing everything. So we have to work for it. But if we work for that, we dig, how much more meaningful is that going to be for us in our Yiddishkeit, in our Judaism? You know, Yitzchak, you know, the Torah tells us that he redug all the wells that Abraham dug. So what is the Torah telling us all this? You know, I've got my own problems. Okay, so you have to dig a couple wells. But part of this is the following. Yitzchak had a different challenge than Abraham. You know, Abraham's like a Baal Tshuva, you know, where he's a convert even. The idea is that he had to discover his Judaism from scratch. So that's very hard to do, right? Nobody is worshiping this, and you had to fight the whole world. But once you do it, that's incredibly inspirational. Yitzchak's given all his religion. And that's what a lot of our kids struggle with, right? But Yitzchak Jews are like, well, my parents are just giving this, and my teachers are just giving it, right? And Yitzchak's challenge is no, you still have to protect that well. You have to make it meaningful for yourself, and you have to make it new for yourself. You're right. You don't get the excitement of saying, I discovered Judaism, or I discovered even the well. My parents told me where the well was, but I got to keep it open. I have to make it meaningful for myself. It's a different challenge. But once again, it's the effort that's going to go into it, which is going to make it really meaningful for us. Now, Hanukkah comes from the word chinuch. Chinuch means two things. We use it to mean teaching. Chinuch means teaching. But it really comes from the word beginning. Chanukah tamizbeach, because they reopen the Beit HaMikdash once again. But once again, we have a connection between Hanukkah and teaching. So what is this? So perhaps what we can say is, perhaps I'd like to suggest perhaps two things. One is, maybe the first thing that we should be teaching our children is to believe in miracles. You know, sometimes, you know, we live in a world we're too jaded, you know, to say things that are going to sound too out there. Maybe the first thing when our children are young and when they're pure is to teach them that there's something out there, there's something that's greater than us. And maybe Hanukkah is about miracles. Maybe we start teaching them that there's a whole higher level over there. You have to work to get there, but it's really there. Let's believe in miracles. There's a book written called Saving Childhood. It's written by Diane and Peter Medved. I think that she is a psychologist, and I believe that he is a radio host, I think, in California. So they wrote a book together. So they have a chapter in there talking about, it's a parenting book. They say, they saw a trend that a lot of parents are telling their kids, you know, the truth about Santa Claus, or the Easter Bunny, or the Tooth Fairy, or whatever. And the parents are doing this. Why? Because they don't want to, you know, they want to like lie to your kid, build them all up, and then one day they find out that it's all a bunch of baloney. So they say, yeah, there's no real such thing as Santa Claus. There's no real such thing as this. So he writes, they write in this book, they say, that's the worst thing to do. Why? Are we advocating making up characters for our children? So they say, listen, children want to be optimistic. Children want to believe in ideals and about things being special. So you're right, maybe there's no actual such a thing as Santa Claus, but what it represents, the idea of giving, or the idea of, you know, I guess, reward and punishment, you know, the idea that you have to do the right thing, you'll be rewarded, that's a very real idea. So it's just when your kids are young, tell them that Santa Claus is real, tell them that the tooth fairy is real. Okay, when they get older, but they'll have grown up, don't take away their optimism that they want. So I guess this is the first, you know, shir that you've ever been to at a yeshiva where the rabbi was advocating believing in Santa Claus. It was the first for everything. But our children want optimism, and they want to believe in miracles, and we believe in miracles. So maybe Hanukkah is saying, you know, let's not be so, let's not hold it back so much with the Greeks. We're coming up this week's Parsha Ephraim and Menashe were born. We'll use this as a concluding point. Ephraim and Menashe were born. Torah tells us Yosef, okay, he's kidnapped away from his family. He's in Egypt, gets married, starts family. Ephraim and Menashe were born. We don't hear another thing about these boys. He names them. He says, I name one Menashe, from the word Nashani. I've forgotten the pain of my father's home. He names the second child Ephraim, from the word Pri. I've become fruitful in this land, which is not mine. And then we don't hear a thing about these kids again until the end of Bereishis, when very famously Yaakov Avinu switches his hands on the kids. And he ends up putting his right hand on the younger kid. And amazingly, we do this. This is how we bless our boys. It's a strange thing. We almost know nothing about Ephraim and Menashe. We bless our girls. It makes perfect sense. Sarah, Rivka, Rachel, Leah. It makes sense. Ephraim and Menashe are two kids who were brought up in Egypt. We don't know almost anything about them. How can we pick Ephraim and Menashe to bless all of our boys with? Bless them to be like Avram, Yitzhak, Yaakov. So there's what to be written about on this. And I'll share with you something so incredible that I heard from, in the name of Aryeh Carmel, who's the greatest student of Rabbi Yoshua Dessler, who was the head of the, I believe he was the head of the Panovich Yeshiva in Jerusalem 50 years ago or so. He says an amazing thing. He goes, you know, you're right. We don't know really anything about Ephraim and Menashe, the details of their life. We do know that they were incredibly righteous. We do know that they became the level of righteousness of all the other tribes. Even though the other tribes grew up on Yaakov Avinu's lap, even though the other tribes were in Israel. So then what are we really blessing our boys with to be like Ephraim and Menashe? What yeshiva did these guys go to? They're the only Jews in the whole of Egypt. You know, if we look at Rashi, it's clear from there that Menashe was Yosef's translator. That when Yosef was talking to the brothers and he was concealing his identity, so he was pretending, Yosef was pretending he didn't speak Hebrew, so he puts a maturgon, he put the translator between him and the brothers. So Rashi tells us that it was Menashe, it was his own son, which means that he had his at least one of them. But it's fair to assume both of them, that they weren't off in some yeshiva somewhere in the middle of nowhere. But we see that Menashe for sure was involved in the government. They were right in the middle of Egyptian society. In fact, when Yosef brings Yaakov, when Yosef brings those boys to Yaakov to bless them at the end of Bereishis, Yaakov says, "Mi Eile." He goes, "Who are these kids?" And one of the explanations are, they look like Egyptians. They were wearing everything from the Egyptian Gap and everything else, and Yaakov's like, "Who are these kids?" He's like, "These are my kids." Even though they may look on the outside like everybody else. So they were brought up in Egypt, not sheltered, in the middle of Egyptian, perhaps even government. They certainly weren't in a yeshiva. There certainly weren't Shabbos groups going on in their shul. So where'd they get their Yiddishkeit from? They got it from the modeling of Yosef and his wife. That's all they had. They were watching their father. They watched their father, who was a person who was in government and who was always honest. He always had the word of God on his lips. They got it from their house. They got it from the modeling of what they saw, because they weren't getting it from anywhere else. So on a certain level, Rabbi Carmel says, when we bless our children to be like Ephraim and Menashe, we're really blessing ourselves, that we should be able to model Yiddishkeit for our children the way Yosef modeled it for Ephraim and Menashe, to bring them up that way. So if we live a life where we're always connecting things to the miraculous, where we're saying that this might not be easy, but we're going to search to find truth, to find spirituality without prophecy in a darkness of Greece, that we're going to look for something special and hand that over to our children, that's the best Hanukkah present that we can give to them. Share, we'll conclude with a story. You know, Chabad's very big into shlich and sending their yeshiva boys, and eventually when they get older, families out all over the world to spread Yiddishkeit, or to find Jews. I read to you this incredible story. It's told by a Rabbi Avram Berkowitz. He says he was a yeshiva boy. This happened in the mid-1990s. And he was sent out to Alaska. Why not, right? He was sent out to Alaska to find some Jews. So he says they went to some place in the northwest edge of Alaska. He's schlepping out there with his one friend, thinking to himself, what in the world am I doing here? I mean, I feel that way when we go on, you know, like Junior Freeze Fest, just what in tarnation are we doing in this snow-covered plant, you know? But there's like cities there, there's a mall there. He's out there in nowhere. And they go, okay, but they were sent out there to try to find Jews. They meet the mayor of this town. He says, the town was mostly Native Americans. He says, are any Jews here? He says, no. He says, well, can we go speak to the local school? happy that anybody even showed up out there. The story happens in the Yupik territory of Alaska. So they get the 4th through 8th grade. And these guys talk a little bit about being Jewish and what being a Jew is, you know. Says that the kids did for them some Eskimo dances, and they did some Hasidic dances, you know, for the kids. And at the very end, he knew that he was sent out there to try to see if, you know, as remote as it might be, would there be any Jews there. So he says, knowing that the Rebbe wanted them to find Jews if they could, Berkowitz asked the students, did any of you ever meet a Jew? So one girl in the room raises her hand, says, who? She goes, my mother. She's right over there. And she points to the 5th grade teacher at the school. So after the lecture is over, this woman comes over to Rabbi Berkowitz. He's not a rabbi at that time. He's the yeshiva guy. She was moved by the whole experience. So she says the following. She says, my daughter might not ever meet another rabbi again in her life. Turns out that she was a girl who grew up in America in the lower 48 states. She loved nature. She was hiking. She went up to Alaska and hiking. She fell in love with a native man. And she was living in some Eskimo, you know, village up there. So she says, I ask you to give my daughter a message that she'll always be proud of her Jewish heritage. Wow, it's pretty heavy. It's called a once-in-a-lifetime encounter. So he says to the girl, he knew that making mitzvos meaningful is if a person can have a personal connection to a mitzvah, it'll last much longer. So he's trying to connect something that this girl can do out here in the Yupik territory of Alaska that can be meaningful spiritually to her. So he says to her the following, do you know what Shabbos candles are? Do you know how Jewish women, mothers and daughters, busher in the Shabbos? So he says to her, where's the first place in the world where the sun sets? The girl who knew her geography said, probably New Zealand or Australia, which is correct. Berkowitz told her, that's right. Jewish women in New Zealand and Australia are the first to usher in Shabbos. And then Shabbos is ushered in with lit candles in Asia, in Israel, in Europe, and then in New York, Chicago, Seattle, and Anchorage. And he says, and even then, there's one part of the world where the sun has not yet set. Here in the Yupik territory of Alaska, where mothers and daughters around the globe have welcomed the Shabbos, God and the Jewish people are still waiting for you, the last Jewish girl in the world, to light the Shabbos candles. Shabbos is telling us, Hanukkah is telling us, that in a world with so much darkness, in a world that just wants to explain things without meaning, that last jug of oil is there. Might be thousands of them that are open and that are not pure anymore. Keep searching. Keep searching, you'll get your miracle. Maybe it's not gonna fall out of the sky anymore. Go through all of those broken vessels and you'll find that one. Go to that well, dig to the bottom of it. You'll find all of those things. That'll be the second luchos. It's a lot harder for us. It's a lot darker for us. Hanukkah happens physically, it's the darkest days of the year. And what Hanukkah is telling us is you'll find that light in the darkness. It may be the last place you'll ever expect it. But search for it, search for it, you'll find that you'll get your miracle. And a happy Hanukkah for everybody, for us, our families, our children.